So movie making, as you know, a movie, as you know, is basically a sequence of shots, and the shots themselves may be beautiful or strange, maybe dynamic, maybe still, bright or dark. Okay, and viewed individually, they might carry some meaning. If you see the shots differently, means if you join the shots, then it will create a different meaning. But the real power of narrative cinema comes when you put those shots together. So when you are putting it, when you are seeing it independently, it creates a different meaning, and when you are putting it together, it creates a different meaning. Okay, so that's why this plays a very important role in visual storytelling. And just wait. In the visual storytelling but as I have said, if we put together, then we can create a different meaning into it. Okay, so suddenly they have context. So they react to one another, surprising us and putting us at ease. Okay, so cut together, these shots can create a whole new levels of meaning and evoke emotions. So our main target in editing to join the two pictures and create emotions in it, and that only cinema can do it. That only cinema can do it. That we are putting two individual pieces. Okay, putting two realistic pieces. That's it's such a recording medium that can create a different emotions. Okay, that can evoke a different emotions, and the person whose job it is to make those cards, to discover that emotional and narrative thing, is the editor. Okay, so like cinematographers, production designers, directors, costume designers, makeup artists, editor must be part technician, is a part craftsman, and part creative artist. Okay. So they are responsible, editors are responsible for understanding the technology of post-production. It is required because nowadays we need to work in softwares, different softwares for joining the shots. Earlier also we have to depend on that film editing machines. It was not a software, but it was a different technology into it. Okay. So now from editing software to integrating sound design, not only you have to join the shots, you have to understand the music also. You have to understand the sound design also, and definitely special effects also. Okay. So, but they also need to have a deep understanding, not only about the technology, not only about the sound design, music, and special effects. They also need to have a deep understanding of film grammar. Film grammar. And a gut to take decisions, a gut instinct for character, okay, and a powerful sense of timing. How much he or she should know how the audience will react by watching that shot, or how much they can tolerate that shot, how much they can watch that shot. Okay, so you can say that they are the final guardians of the story and the emotional landscape of the movie that we watch into that visual storytelling in cinema. Okay, so as we know, that narrative film is a very fragile thing, and if we misplace one cut, then it can drastically change its meaning and impact. Okay, but as crucial as it is, that the editor's job is also to hide their work. Nobody knows that who has edited. Okay, so it's an invisible art, you can say. An editor should have less ego. We'll discuss this later on. What is the job of this editor? How the market is right now? What are the opportunities that we have right now? Okay, how we can learn this art? Okay, we'll discuss in details. And after that, if you have any kind of questions at the end of the sessions, you can ask. I hope that I will try to cover up all the queries that you might ask me. Still, if you have at the end of the session, if you have any question, then you can ask me. Okay, so I will just move on. Okay, so usually this editor's job is to make cards appear so seamless that the audience does not even notice them at all. That's why this is called an invisible art. Okay. So like so many great artists, the best editors make their walks look effortless. Yes, they look effortless. It's not like, it's a very tough thing. It's a very tough thing. No, we have to do so many things. Individually, you need to put this sort, join the sort, then you have to create. No, a good editor, a great editor, great artist means you can say, like a great artist, that they can do the any kind of walks, means their genre of walks, their subject of walks easily. The editors can also look it so effortlessly. Okay, so among their duties, just sorting ski, editors must be able to sort through hours and hours of raw footage to find the story. He should have very good presence into it. Okay, so they should train their visual memories to remember the difference, tiny differences between that text and the shots, and imagine how they might be cut together. Okay, so all these things must help the director separate the movie they wanted to make from the movies they actually shot. So in many times, in my experience, I have found that while editing some of the documentaries of Government India, also Government Divisions, okay, Central Institute of Indian Languages, that the script, the theme of the story is intact, but while editing, whatever we have scripted at the time, it's changing completely. We have not got that kind of shot that we have thought. We have got a different kind of interviews. Okay, so we need to compile it again and need to make a different story into it by keeping the theme intact. Okay, so let's move on. So what film editing is? So what is film editing? First, we need to understand what film editing is. So film editing is the art and craft of cutting and assembling films together to make a coherent story. So this work is done by the film editor, and who actually visualizes, who actually brings the director's vision into our screen. So the creative choice of the editors are usually a combination of what they think is best for the film and what the director and the producers also want for the finished project. Okay, so this is mostly done during post-production, means after the principal photography, this is done. Okay, so aspects of film editing can involve physical strips of celluloid, editing or joining the physical strips of celluloid films or digital films, or maybe both. Okay, or maybe both. Here we can see that there is a image that is here. If we can see that two sorts are different. This is a Kulosov effect example. Okay, so this technique was at the time invented by one of the greatest film researcher at the time, 1917 or 18 at the time. So Russian filmmaker plus film researcher at the time. Lev Kulosov found that at the very beginning there was no editing at that time. We know that in the early stages, they used to shoot only that much that the film roll was capable of. So as soon as the film roll was finished, they used to stop it. And once Lumiere brothers, those who have brought this cinematography technology to us, once said ki film has no future, because film cannot tell the stories. Okay. Later, Edwin S. Porter, D.W. Griffith made some movies and they proved, yes, film has a language. So if we put two different shots, then it can create meaning. So here, a bowl of soup and the face of a person can create a sense of hunger. So no need for any kind of dialogue, no need for any kind of explanation into it. We can easily understand, yes, the man is hungry. Okay, and if we replace this bowl of salt with a coffin salt or a funeral kind of salt or a sad salt, then it will create a sadness. And if we replace this funeral salts or coffin salts with a beautiful woman, then it will create a desire. So it creates a different meaning into it. Okay, so it's like that you are going to the college, as I used to give this example to the students, because it is day-to-day affair for us. So if you are going out of the home, and after that, or before that, means going out of the home, it's okay, chalo, before that, or after that, if you are putting two shots, okay? I'm going out of the home, then the university shot is shown, everybody will think that the person is going to the university. Correct. And we replace that university shot with a shopping mall shot, and everybody will think that that person has gone out of the home to go to the shopping mall. So change of only one single shot can create a different meaning. Okay, this is a very simple thing. Okay, now what is the film editor's job? What is the film editor's job? The film editor is in charge of cutting and assembling the raw footage shot by the director into a coherent or cohesive final product. Okay, an editor's job includes watching all of the film footage. That's why this person needs much patience, a cool head, much patience, almost try to control his ego. Okay, human beings are trained to incline to that ego, but still this kind of job requires a less ego. Okay, so short for motion pictures. The editor's job includes watching all of the film footages, short for motion pictures or television programs, selecting which footage to use, means he has to select. He needs to have a sense of selection. Okay, you need to select a good shot and a bad shot. Sometimes a bad shot is defined by the production team or the director. Sometimes that bad shot was used at the time of editing. The editor picked that bad shot to create a meaning into it. Okay, and then using editing software to assemble that footage. Nowadays it is an editing software. Earlier it was an editing machine, Steinberg came and movie over. Okay, assemble that footage into a completed feature film, episode of television, or another piece of work, any kind of audiovisual work. Maybe a music video, maybe a wedding video, it may be an event video, maybe a short film. Okay, it may be a TikTok video, social media video also. It doesn't matter. It should have a story. Okay, so oftentimes, sometimes, means most of the times, this process involves watching and logging the footage. Logging the footage means this needs to be kept into that drive properly in a proper manner. Okay? And organize the footage by scenes and takes, and then setting the story alongside the director. Okay? You should discuss with the directors, and the directors should also give independence to the editor also. Okay? To portray his perspective or her perspective. What is this career like? Because we need to become a film editor, as is the topic of this webinar. Okay, so what is this career like? The film and video editors typically work in studios or in office settings. Nearly all editing work is done on a computer nowadays. And editors often are trained in a specific type of editing software, like Adobe Premiere, Avid Media Composer, or Final Cut Pro, or DaVinci Resolve. Okay, so you need to have some skills, software skills and technical skills. So editing as a career, how it will grow? Those who are thinking, it's a common thinking for many of us. If I work as an editor, then how I will survive? How I will survive? So what is the prospect? What is the prospect of choosing this as a career, as an editor, editing as a career? Now, editing is the most lucrative job and is the most available job right now in the industry. Okay. The television industry requires very good editors, skillful editors. Now, overall, the employment of film and video editors is projected to grow 29% from 2020 to 30 in the next 10 years. Okay. So, 1 year has also passed around 8 to 9 years. It will grow in 29%, much faster than average for all of us. This survey has been done. This report has been prepared by Job Outlook, an American film magazine that looks after the job prospects. Okay, so because the number of internet-only platforms such as streaming devices, OTT platforms, is likely to increase, as we can all know, in the last 1.5 years, it has increased a lot. It had increased manifold. Okay, so along with the number of source produced for this kind of platforms, now it is overcoming means it is overdoing the job of the television source. Okay, so the broadcasting thing is changing. So this growth may lead to more work for film and editors. Okay, so filmmakers and editors also. Sorry, it's a mistake. Okay. So some of the things that the video and the film editors might do, what they do actually, to edit footage for television programs, motion pictures, music videos, documentaries, news, sporting events, wedding videos, okay, social media videos. Organize and edit digital footage with video editing software, nonlinear software requirements. Okay. Collaborate with the director to determine the overall vision of the production. This is very much required because a good director always works with only one editor. Fixed. Okay, I will tell you later on how Spielberg uses only one editor, how Martin Scorsese used only one editor, how Christopher Nolan used one editor. Okay. Discuss editing techniques with the director to improve a scene. Okay, and another thing, and edit a scene based on the director's vision. You need to understand the director's vision also. That's why there is a sync between the director and the editor. And once it is fixed, the director always wants to work with the same editor. It's not like, you know, this project I am working with this editor, editor A, then in the next project I will work with editor B. It does not happen. In my works also, I have some fixed directors. I worked with them. And they also never worked with other editors. So there was a collaboration and understanding between these two persons. Okay. Another thing one must remember, okay, at the time of filmmaking, at the time of production, there will be around hundreds of people working together. But at the time of production, post-production, at the time of editing, that is the major part of the post-production. Okay. There are only one person actually works, that is the editor. And it is the editor's job to edit the scene based on the director's vision. That's why it's called. Okay. So in the beginning, how do they do it? How it actually evolved? So in the very beginning, the editors worked with razor blades. They used to cut it and tape to physically slice the film into shots and join those shots together. Okay, they used to cut it like this and join it. Okay, and join it together. So it was painstaking. One cut could take several minutes. At that time, it was it's not so much easy that in editing software as we do it right now, it only takes a fraction of seconds to cut a scene. Okay, it was also more difficult to experiment with various cuts. At that time, there was not so much option. Even if you want to put any dissolve opticals, that was called the opticals at that time. Okay, it was also costly. Nowadays, it doesn't matter. It will not cost you anything to put a dissolve, to put any kind of transitions. In film, it was very tough. It was costly and it was time taking. Okay, so that was not easy. We going to go back and undo a particular edit also. It was a linear kind of edit. We could not, once we have edited it and joined it, we cannot go back over it. And we cannot re-edit it again. Okay, so just more razor blades, tape and time. It will only take your time. Okay, so at the very beginning in the 1920s, an editing machine called Moviola became standard equipment for editors. So what was the specialty of it? That you can edit it and you can watch it also while editing it, the footage. Okay, so I'm not showing the videos and all these things of Moviolas, because this is for the career prospects of video editing. I'm just explaining this process actually, so that you can just have an outline idea of it. Okay. So in addition to streamlining the process, the movie allowed editors to watch the film as they were making the cuts. This is the specialty of this machine. And it was in the very early stage, 1920s, 100 years back from now. More than 100 years back. Okay. And this was a, that person in movie, you cannot, that person has to stand. This was a standing. Okay, so this person is a straight, this machine is a straight, very straightforward machine. Means there was not so much option. You cannot put the sound also, you cannot hear the sounds also. And then in the 1970s, flatbed editing system, you can see it's like a table, flatbed, that's why it's called a flatbed. Steinbeck and Kame arrived. Okay, now editors could move the film backward, forward. They can move backward, forward, examine their edits. It has improved. Now it took 50 years to develop another technology. Okay, and listen to the recorded sound as they want. So from 1920s to 70s, it improved a lot. And almost all of the film, film editing in the 90s, 80s, okay. So edited in Steinbeck, flatbed machine. And flatbed remained the industry standard until the 1990s. Okay, until the 1990s. If anybody has unmuted, then please mute yourself. There's some sound coming up. Okay, so it remained the industry standard until the 1990s when digital editing systems like Abhijit emerged. Abhijit emerged in 1994 most probably because the year the Saving Private Ryan won the film editing Oscar. That was 1994. It was very ironic that Abhijit won the most innovative software. Means Innovative Digital Technologies Award, Digital Technology Award at that year, in the Academy Awards. Whereas the film that has been edited in Steinbeck was awarded as the Best Film Editing Award. Okay, that was in Saving Private Ryan. So it's very ironic. So this proves that technology can only help you, but it will, the aesthetics and the joining of the shots, the meaning of the shots will remain the same for you. It will not put any kind of difference in it. Okay, so technology only help you to portray your vision easily. Now, there are two processes of editing. Okay, one is called the linear editing. We refer to the physical film editing, or in the tape-based editing also, in the videotape also, there was a linear editing. Because this process involves editing your way through the scene or the film in sequence, shot by shot, and choosing cut points as you go. So it's called the destructive editing. Since the editor is literally cutting the film, cutting and joining it, and altering it with each transitions between shots. So let's look into it. So it cuts the shot like this physically, and then to join it, okay, so this one is the physical cutting. That's why it's a linear process. Okay, it's a linear process. And then it comes to that non-linear process, and there is a software test. We are editing that thing in right now. We are using this non-linear editing technology. Okay, so digitally we are editing it using computer software. That process is called non-linear editing. And you can scroll to any point in the scene. You can take any scene anywhere. You can take any scene anywhere or in the film with the touch of a button, joining and rejoining shots in any order as many times as you want. That's why this is called the non-destructivity. It's called the non-destructivity. You can place the shot anywhere. You can replace it with anything. Okay, you can join it. It does not matter. You can easily do it. Okay, and this actually happened when the computer. So before we do not have any computer, It was not called any kind of nonlinear editing. The nonlinear term actually came when the Computer Editing Act. Okay, so these are the three major nonlinear editing software that is ruling the film industry for many years also. It is ruling the industry right now also. Okay, so the main nonlinear editing system include Avid, Avid Spinal Cut Pro, and Adobe Premiere. So each system has its own drawbacks and benefits, and each editor, that's why you need to have some experience. I started my editing, most of the major editing in Premiere, Premiere 1.5, Premiere Pro. Then I have edited many of the projects in Final Cut Pro. Then again, I am back to that Adobe Premiere. So it doesn't matter right now, it doesn't matter whether I am editing in Adobe Premiere or Final Cut Pro. Okay? But still, each editor must figure out what works best for each project. What kind of project is that? You need to understand that thing in terms of budget, workflow, and use. And how comfortable you are, with that workflow. You need to understand that thing. It's not like, and it is a very wrong concept that a Final Cut Pro can give you a good editing while Adobe Premiere cannot. It's a very wrong concept. Anything you can edit in your quality will not affect it. Quality will remain the same. It's the option, it's the shortcuts that the software gives. That actually helps to build the movie. So this is the breakdown of the editing process. So first, all of the footage is imported. Means imported into what? Imported into your computer hard disk. Okay, or storage, or in the storage. Okay, you need to, all of the footage is imported. Then the media is transported into a workable codec. Why workable codec? Because it may be shot in raw footage. The footage may be shot in raw footage. That is one of the uncompressed format that a film camera, specific film camera, which is specific model can shoot. Company, film camera company can shoot. They need to process it into a workable codec, maybe MP4, maybe ProRes, okay, maybe AVI, whatever format you like, if that is compatible. And you need to understand also with the workflow, what that software can actually work into it. Whether that in Premiere it works, that MP4 works best, or that MOV works best, it depends on that operating system also, depends on that, editing software also. Okay, so the shots needs to be organized by scenes and takes, definitely. All the scenes needs to be organized by scenes and takes. Okay, because there may be many takes into it. You need to see it with the assistant director and the director and the director's team. And they will show you key. This is the right shot, this is the wrong shot. This shot is there. You can get this close-up of these action shots in this number of, in this time code. Okay, so as the director's team are present into the production stage, so they have copied all the informations of the shots that are taken by time code, by writing the time code of that exact card or exact cassette or exact reel. Time code for reel, it is prints and feeds. For tape and digital videos and SSDs videos, they have their time code. They need to note down that time code. Okay, we have this Esplanade markets shots in this 10 minutes, 10 seconds time. 10 minutes, 10 seconds, card one. Okay, and then all the footage is viewed at least once. Editor should have that presence. Okay, that person should have that presence to watch those footage at least one. Maybe sometimes you have to, that person needs to watch it several times, but at least once that person needs to watch it in real time, not in fast forward, not in fast backward or slow motion like this, needs to watch it in real time. Okay, and then an assembly cut is created. Assembly cut means whatever the correct shots are there, they need to put it into the timeline. Okay, and then a rough cut is made. Rough cut means according to the story, according to the script, there is no fine cut into it. Match cut is not done properly. But they are just putting into that shots, different angle shots, side by side, and they're watching how the timeline, how the story will look. So if my projected time is around 90 minutes for a feature film, my rough cut may look, my rough cut timeline may be of around 180 minutes, 3 hours of time. Then again, you need to second rough cut, you need to put it, you need to cut it. Then a fine cut is quick, then a fine cut is made, and it will be brought to around 190 minutes or 10 minutes plus minus. Okay, 190 minutes or 110 minutes or 105 minutes, it depends on the feature film. And if it is a television project, nowadays television projects, you cannot move, means you have to be exactly that time code. Means if it is of 21 minutes, then you have to cut it up to 20 minutes, 21 minutes. You cannot increase one frame also. Okay, and then the picture lock is set, and in between this fine cut and this picture lock, there is the sound processing is done, sound recording is done, sound syncing is done. And when the picture is locked, after that, it may go for the final sound, it may go for the final sound mixing, and then it will go for the color corrections. Okay, so this is only the editing process. There are other processes also, that sound is there, that color corrections is there. Okay, after that. So what are the skills that every filmmaker needs to do this kind of job? Okay, the big picture thinking, he needs to understand problem solving. He can solve the problem, because there may be many problems into that editing, you know. You may find that one of the shot that is going properly okay with that particular shot, you are finding it that it has a set into it, or it is out of focus shot. You have to solve this issue. You have to be being detail oriented. You have to be good in communications. Okay, so what is big picture thing? So the job description of a film editor includes more than just placing the shots. It's not like only you just put into that shots, you are just joining the shots. Okay, they must analyze the entirety of the footage. How much footage is there? Deciding how best to achieve the desired emotional and thematic impact of a film. That means constantly making decisions on a macro as well as micro. You have to think into that macro level also, and minute details you need to understand also. The one frame movement can also change the meaning. One frame or 5 frames. Okay? So you need to have this kind of thinking constantly. That's why this is called the big picture thinking. Then you have to have the ability to problem solving. Okay, so editor work in the business of daily problem solving. Daily, there are lots and lots of problems that is solved into the editing room, and you will find this word into that shooting also. That this problem will be solved if any kind of error happens at the time of production. The production team actually says this can be solved into the editing. This can be solved into the post production. This can be solved into the color correction, right? So that editor must have that problem solving ability. So if there is any kind of shot problem, if any kind of action continuity problem, if any kind of problem to that actors, that editor must solve it by hiding that shots, by cutting into the different shots, by using some cutaway shots. Okay. By using with other sorts, that editor must have that kind of thinking into it. Okay, sometimes an actor's performance is weak and the editor must cut around it. Other times, the main storyline isn't tracking and it is the editor's job to piece the creative source. So editor must be prepared to identify problems and offer solutions, because you have to solve it properly over here. Because the entire film is in your hand. Okay, then being detail oriented. The editors have the look at every single frame by the videographer. Okay, now with digital video, that means hundreds and thousands of hours of footage. You can see that one of the most of the documentaries that is running into that all the time. You can see in Nat Geo, National Geographic, and the Discovery. All these programs have shot in around means hundreds of hours of footage is there. 1 hour of final project took around 100 hours of footage. So you have to have the ability to watch those things properly so that you should not miss any good footage. Suppose if you miss any good footage, then the cinematographer's job, you cannot justify the cinematographer's job also. Okay. So you need to justify the crew members, whatever they have worked, whatever they have, their hard work is done into that production team, production time, you need to understand it also, and you need to portray it. You need to find that good sound and make decision down to the microsecond. Okay, editor must then take this footage, whittle it down to a manageable length. You need to understand the length. That's why I'm telling you 100 hours of footage may be there. You need to crop it down to 1 hour. It's such a tough thing. And make decision down to the microseconds. How to cut between the shots. In other words, editor must constantly focus on the details. That's why editor have to be very, very patient and cool level. Okay. And communications. Yes. Communication means you need to have a very good communication with the director specifically. You need to understand the director specifically. That's why, as I have told, the director do not change the editor. Once it is fixed, they fix upon that editor. Okay. So that means editor needs to be able to communicate with the director as well as articulate creative vision that the film has. You need to understand the thought of the director. Okay. Communication, yeah, communication means communicating, means you need to understand the visual communication. You need to understand the thought of the directors. Okay, so how to become a film editor? Now we have learned what are the skills that we require, what is the market prospects. Now how to become a film editor? What we have to do to become a film editor? Principal film video editor, what you need to do? You need to watch the movies, go to a film school, work on entry-level jobs, you need to build a competitive portfolio, and then you need to advance your career. Okay, so how to do it? We'll explain these things. We need to watch movies. We need to watch movies. Okay? Aspiring video editors should spend watching as many movies, TV shows, music videos, every genre of television shows. There are lots of television shows running right now also. It's running 24 hours. You need to watch game shows, you need to watch news, you need to watch documentaries, okay. You need to watch music videos, dramas, okay. You do not know in which field you will work later on, or initially in which field you have to start. You should not deny it. You know, this is not my genre. I will tell you later on. Okay. Pay attention to the rhythm. You need to understand the rhythm, pacing, how they are joining the shots, how much they are keeping the shots, okay? And how long does each shot, each scene last? How quickly is the editor cutting between shots? How is the editor using sound effects or visual cues to add tension, drama, or levity to a scene? Means more detailing to the scene. Paying specific attention to editor's work in film will help you develop your own film editing style and technique. That means you need to watch lots and lots of television programs. Okay, television program to educate yourself in filmmaking and film editing. Okay, that means you need to study films. You can join the film school. This actually helps because here also many of the students are of film schools, most of them. Almost all I can say are from the film school. So film school actually helps you in shaping your filmmaking ideas. Okay, you can enroll in a film school, university, or community college that offer degree programs in film production, or any of the things. You can study mass communication, you can study BFA in digital filmmaking, you can study BSc in filmmaking, you can study BSc in animations also, whatever. Related to that, any kind of filmmaking subjects, if you study there, if you study in a degree college, okay, degree college, then it will give you an idea. It will provide you with access to film editing courses and the type of software often used to edit film and video, such as Final Cut Pro and Adobe Premiere. Okay, these are the most two used software right now. The film school coursework will also generally include training in other aspects of film production, not only film editing, but other aspects of film production also, and the post-production process include visual effects, VFX, film and TV directions, cinematography, screenwriting, sound effects, and general film theory. This is required. Okay, all of which are essential in giving film and video editors well-rounded understanding of visual story. But why should I learn cinematography when I'm working in a video editing course? Because you need to understand the angles and all. Why should I need to understand this screenwriting? Because you need to understand the narrative. Okay, why should I need to understand the sound effects? Because in television projects, the editor do all the things, from the sound to color corrections to everything, from the graphics, everything. Okay. Now, after you do this, learn this film editing, filmmaking from film school, you can work on any kind of entry-level jobs. This is a very bad idea that a student is thinking, no, I need to do the editing in Premiere only, or I need to be an editor only. I want to be an editor. Why should I work in a production team? Why should I work in a assistant direction team? I need to be an editor. No, you are not specialized right now. You are an observer right now. First you have learned, you are learning still now. You are an observer. Okay. So take any kind of job, it does not matter, related to filmmaking, any kind of job, you take it, you need to understand it, okay? So start out small by looking for smaller local production by continuing to collaborate with peers, okay? You can work on your own, as many of our students also work on their own, okay? They are collaborating with some of the friends, then they are doing some productions, then we are doing some short films like this. Okay, you have met along the way, you have made some new friends into it, and you are finding, yes, this person, can, this Mr. A can actually do cinematography well, he is very good photographer, so I should utilize him to do my production. Yes, this person is an editor, I want to create this story. Okay, so I can go for a project. Okay, this will help you to develop your project, develop your portfolios also. Volunteer your service if possible. Do not go for any kind of money making or earning from the very beginning. If you are getting a good job, it may not pay you, but you should stay there to get an opportunity to learn from it. Okay, this reminds me of my career also. I used to travel from Durgapur to Kolkata to watch editing in studios for a few hours only. Then I have to go back over there. Okay, and I was not paid. It does not matter. Reversely, what happened? I used to take some cigarettes for that, for my teacher at that time. Because I knew one thing, if I had to learn all these things in an institute or something, then I have to pay. It's the same thing that I am learning here. Let me learn, then I will learn later on. And that will actually help you to get the projects. And yes, that helped me. That actually helped me to get the sources at that time. Yes, this person is good, this person works good. So if you need one editor, that person actually referred to me. Then I worked in some of the projects. It started, then my career started from there. Okay. So consult your professors in the film school and try to access their networks while you are in a film school. That we constantly tell to our students as a faculty of filmmaking. Then you need to access our networks also, you need to keep good relations with it. Because we have many of the opportunities, it comes constantly. At that time, if we find any good students, then we can refer. But if these students are not suitable for it, then we do not refer it. Then we do not have any options. Okay, so this will help you to land good job, good internships or apprentice. In many of the internships, it is not paid at all. Remember. So take any job that comes along, any kind of job, whether it's a production assistant, whether you are a secretary at the office of a film production, or a runner for a production. Runner means the person who actually takes the hard disks or the reels from the editor, from the production house to the television channel or to the another production house. Not skilled job, but still, you will get to know the process. You can interact with those persons. You are getting this opportunity. Okay? If you meet people who work in the editing room, while you are studying or while you are meeting with some of the persons, ask if you may occasionally join them to observe and learn. You can ask, yes, may I join in your editing room? May I join for this production? When your next production will happen, may I join it? I will not charge anything. I do not need any money or things. I just need to observe. Just need to observe. This is the great opportunity to learn. This one day of observation will give you around 1 or 2 months of experience. Of means learning and all. This actually helps a lot. Okay? Build a competitive portfolio. The market is very, very competitive, because many persons are working in this field. Earlier, there are very few persons, very few skilled persons. Very few persons knew the softwares and all. Now everybody knows it. Not only softwares, everybody now have their computers in their pocket, have their very good camera in their pocket. They can capture videos, they can edit in any kind of video apps. So many persons think that that person is an editor. Yes, definitely. It's the same for the photography also. Okay. So you need to design a very good winning portfolio to market yourself successfully. So what do you have to do? You will find that the applicant pool, means the persons who are applying with you with the same profile for editing job, is instantly competitive. So you have to make yourself stand out. How? Send out your resume along with the reel of your best work to studio executives, directors, and other film directors. I remember once I used to do freelance into the industry. I was out of job for a few months. Means out of job means I had no jobs in the world. So I had applied for many of the television channels at that time. And suddenly it came. Okay. So one of them, one or two, I had been struck. I chose between it and I joined for a few months. Make sure the materials you submit in applications are concise and show up only your best work. Do not add that whatever you have worked on, it's not like it. You have worked in around 10 projects. So out of the 10 projects, what you think is the best projects, you need to apply on it. You need to portray them. You need to make a portfolio out of it. Okay. Ask people with whom you have worked in the past to look over your materials and offer feedback. This is very much required. Your teachers can also do it. Okay? That is the best thing that you can utilize. Or any of the successful people, those people are working into that field, please have a look. Yes, is this profile will help me to get a job? Create a website that offers more substantial selection of your work. Website means I'm not telling you you need to buy that .net, .in, .com. Okay, you can make a WordPress, Blogspot. Okay, it's free. You can also make a social media platforms also. Okay, you can make a social media page also. That will also help. You can make a YouTube page also. Means YouTube channel also. That will also help. Now, how to advance your career? Start out by applying to be an assistant editor on a production. This is very much important. If you assist somebody, then you will. You don't have that whole responsibility, but you are working on these things. Okay, you can directly work into that project. Once you have demonstrated the quality of your work in the independent productions and an assistant director, look for opportunities to take them. Look for opportunities to take that job. I started my career with that assistant, and suddenly I got that opportunity to work as a full-time editor. And once I walked into the full-time editor, I never looked back. Okay, so you must constantly build new connections. Definitely, the connections are important. My phone number is from 2004. I have never changed it. This is my fixed phone number. If I change this phone number, then I may lose connection of whatever I have built till now. Okay, so build a new connections in order to advance to the position of full editor, and I have many contacts with them, and still now we are in very good contact. Those before at the time of 2004-05, the persons we have worked on still now in touch. Consider joining a union for faster career development, because film union, guild, film guild, this actually helps you to keep the job, because film guilds are formed to safeguard your job also and to give you a constant job. So you can join any of the film production union. Okay, that is that here in Kolkata there is a Toliganj, in others also, in other places also there is a film guild, you can join it. Okay. So they have some membership fees, you can join there also. But you need to have some references into it, you need to have that experiences, you need to work as an observer for 2 or 3 projects. Okay. So keep yourself informed about new technologies and softwares, because software may come and go. You are learning in Adobe Premiere, tomorrow Adobe will stop the support of Premiere and it will stop the, suppose Adobe stops that software market and started making sanitizer, suppose. It happened. Kodak stopped making film cameras, film rolls, and started making medicines, right? So keep yourself informed about new technologies and software. This is required. And the last one is, you can start your own editing business or service. Yes, you can do freelance. You can start your own business also. Okay, because every kind of audio visual work, any kind of audio visual work, be it online class or anything, whatever, there is some input of that editor. Editor is required to finish up this project. Okay, you need to go to an editing software to work. So what is the pay? Initially, the payment is low. Initially, the payment is not high. As you are thinking, an engineering job can give you around 30,000 to 50,000 rupees in joining. It's not like that. Initially, one can earn a salary between 8,000 to 15,000. This is reality. I'm not going for any hyper real things. I'm not telling you you will join in 20,000 rupees or something like this. This is the thing. From 8,000 to 15,000 per month in India, you can join with some years of experience, but it actually manifolds. As you gain experience, it increases. It increases a lot. Okay? Means it doubles actually. So with some years of experience and expertise gained in video editing, the video editor's career is on the smooth track with high pay package and other benefits. Okay, and if you are a freelancer, then editor do not have to pay the food bills also, because it's on the production budget. That is one of the major benefits. Okay, so a creative and experienced video editor working for a large studio can earn a salary of anywhere between 30,000 to 80,000. This is for the salaried persons. If you are doing freelance work, then there is no limit. Okay, in 1 month you can earn 1 lakh rupees, in another month you can earn nothing. Maybe. This is the hardcore truth of freelancing. Okay. But another thing is that in freelance, you do not have to work 30 days or 20 days, or you need to work around for a few days. You have the liberty to work. You have a liberty, you have the independence. Okay. So freelance editor must set their own day rate. Means you need to have day rate means one shift. One shift is equal to 8 hours. So in 8 hours, how much you charge? What is your rate? Initially, the rate starts from 500. Then it may go to around 3,000, 4,500, 5,000. But initially, you may start from around 500, or if it's in a voluntary service, then you can charge nothing. Okay. On their expertise and the budget of the film production, seeking to hire them. Editor who are members of the guild, means that is the film union. Okay. For scale established by them. So they have their own scale. If you are working for the guild, if film union gives you some of the works, then they have their own rate, you have to accept it. So rates may vary from project to project. It also varies from project to project. There is no fixed rate. as I'm getting in the here for 500 per day, that means in another project I will get 500. It may increase or may decrease also. Okay. These are some famous film editors. Thelma Schoonmaker, American film editor, and he has worked in many, in almost all of the films of Martin Scorsese. She is renowned filmmaker. She has received 8 Academy Awards or Oscar Awards nominations for Best Film Editing and has won 3 times: Raging Bull, Aviator, Departed. Okay. Which are all Scorsese directed films. So Martin Scorsese worked with Thelma Schoonmaker for all of his projects. As I have said, good director always keeps his reader fixed. They do not change the reader. Okay? Walter Murch, famous film editor, director, writer, sound designer, is very famous for sound editing also. Yes. Created one rule also, the blink of an eye. You can say the blink of an eye is a book, Walter Murch. Okay, and famous 6th rule is there, so that we'll discuss later on. Okay, not today, maybe in another season. Okay, so Walter Murch rules that depends on emotions, cards, and all. Okay, so Walter Murch, American film director, writer, sound designer, is very famous sound designer also. Very famous. He is the editor of Francis Ford Coppola, Godfather, Apocalypse Now. All has been directed by Francis Ford Coppola, and he has won 3 Academy Awards from 9 nominations: 6 for picture editing and 3 for sound mixing. Okay, he has been referred to by Roger Ebert. Roger Ebert is a famous film critic. Okay, famous film critic as the most respected film editor and sound designer in the modern cinema. Michael Kahn is the editor of Spielberg. Spielberg's all of the movies has been directed by, except E.T., Extraterrestrial, except E.T., all of the movies has been directed by, edited by Michael Kahn. Okay, and he has won 3 times Oscar for the 3 times for the Central List, Raiders of Lost Ark, as I have said, Saving Private Ryan, 1998. Yes, it's 1998, not 1994 at the time. So, which are all Spielberg directed. And then it comes to Sally Menke. Sally Menke is no more. Unfortunately, she died of heat stroke. Okay. So, very early age. It's not time to go. But Sally Menke is very famous for Quentin Tarantino. Is the Quentin Tarantino's editor. Okay, Menke was nominated for the Academy Award for Best Film Editing for Pulp Fiction and Inglourious Basterds by Quentin Tarantino. Lee Smith, Christopher Nolan's director. Okay, so he has won Oscar for Best Film Editing, Dunkirk, Dark Knight, Interstellar, for which he won many awards, okay, including the Best Film Editing for Oscar. But for Tenet, Nolan has not used Lee Smith. Okay. Tenet has been edited by somebody else, not by Lee Smith. But except Tenet, all of the Nolan's film has been edited by Lee Smith. So here we can know, be it Lee Smith, be it Sally Menke, Michael Kahn, Walter Murch, Thelma Schoonmaker, everybody worked with a fixed director, or the director worked with this fixed editors. Okay. So, if you need to be an editor, you need to understand these things very well. I hope that I have made clear. If you have any kind of queries, you can ask. Any query?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay. Then I need to end this session with a tip from Thelma Spoonmaker. Okay, I need to play one video of Thelma Spoonmaker. I'm not playing it from here. I'm playing it separately. Okay. So I'm playing it separately. Thelma Spoonmaker, this video is of around 9 minutes. Please watch it. Okay. This will help you a lot because there are lots of film tips that has been given by heart that will help you in your career. Okay. Just wait up.
I think there was one.
I hope the screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Sure. Let's watch these things. This is some 9 minutes. We'll watch it whole. Okay. A lot of information that has been given. I need to wind up after this tip. Okay.
I think the most wonderful thing about editing is that you're given all this raw material and it's your job to make choices, in this case along with Scorsese, into how to focus the scene. You know, when do you cut to a close-up? When do you use wide shots?
A lot of people think editing should be invisible, but we've never felt that way. We always like to slap the audience in the face.
I've known him since he was in his last year at New York University and worked with him then on his first feature film called Who's That Knocking? But we had been working together on documentaries about the war in Vietnam and supporting Martin Luther King. But that documentary style has affected our work very much. We like a certain roughness sometimes that maybe a Hollywood editor wouldn't like.
And Robinson is down for the second time in his career.
Hollywood editors tend to like a slick style of editing where all the bumps are removed, but sometimes Marty and I like to keep in those bumps. Because they add a certain grittiness to the film, a certain reality. Or we like maybe to shock the audience with a cut they're not expecting.
My name is Jordan Belfort. Not him, me.
Which will refresh them and make them look at something in a new way.
Hi, Mom, what do you think?
There's a scene in Goodfellas, for example, the marriage scene, and it's a Jewish wedding, and in the Jewish wedding, the groom breaks a glass under his foot. And the way we cut that, if you look at that sequence, you'll see it's very jaggedly cut in order to accentuate the violence of the breaking of the glass.
Mazel tov!
We forcibly made what was some people would consider an orthodox cut or a bad cut. Some people might consider it a bad cut, but we like that kind of thing.
Maybe we could work something out.
That was quick. Think he's dead already?
You know, Marty usually has a concept, shall I say, for the whole film. What we do is we get the first loose cut and then we start trying to shape it in terms of the concept he has. Mm-hmm. I jump on my timeline and I experiment all the time. So sometimes I'll give Marty 6 edits mm-hmm. to look at instead of one, the more jagged, abrupt cutting of Shutter Island, for example. Because Shutter Island was about someone who's deeply disturbed, we did want to make the cutting jarring and uncomfortable.
I have to go. Please.
Oh,
when we're in dailies together, that's a very important time for me. He's very tough about what he will accept from an actor. He hates any devices that an actor might use. For example, eyebrows are one of his big things. He will not allow eyebrows to be moved, sometimes, but not usually, because he feels that's fake and that's a crutch. Let me put it that way. Part of an editor's job is to make sure an actor's performance is properly put together so that it works on the screen.
McMahon and the Detroit Mafia. Hopperson.
In Irishman, the powerful scene in which he says, "I have to call Hoffa's wife," after he has killed Hoffa.
I should call Joe.
You haven't called Joe yet?
Hello?
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 Joe. Joe?
And there's a jump cut there, which you normally are not supposed to do.
Yeah.
But the take in which De Niro hears her voice on the phone, she says hello, was so perfect. And then the take where he actually carries out the whole conversation with her was from another take. And we tried to morph it. We can do that sometimes. We can make it look as if there isn't a cut.
Sometimes think it's real, but it's only false.
But we finally gave up and Marty said, just leave it as a jump cut. So we did.
Hello?
Hello?
Joe. Joe? It's
Frank.
Yeah.
Frank.
Yeah.
There are quite a few jump cuts in this movie.
What are you going to do now, Jimmy?
Well, the first thing I'm going to do is register with the Federal Probation Office, and then I'm going to go down to Florida with my wife.
And that was his concept for the film, stripped down, very plain. No fancy editing, no fancy camera moves, the violence very quick.
I don't know which way we'll...
over with quickly and shot very blandly, often in wide shots. He wanted the movie very, very simple so that the characters were what you latch on to.
Yours is still there. Your $1.5 million, whatever it is. But mine's gone.
Yeah, mine's still there.
But we're both sitting here.
That's right. Only we're sitting here for different things. You're sitting here for extortion. I'm sitting here for fraud.
And what's the difference?
I didn't threaten anybody. You did.
Well, so what? That makes no sense.
What do you mean? Think about it.
I'm thinking about it, Jimmy. No, don't f*** with me, Jimmy. Just do something about it.
What do you mean, do something about it?
One of the things Marty's always encouraged us to do is to sometimes hold just a little bit too long, where the audience is beginning to get a little worried.
Frankie, we did all we could for the man.
That happens earlier in the movie where the De Niro character has been hired to blow up a laundry and then he's called about it by Harvey Keitel.
What are you doing in Delaware? Bombing out a laundry place.
And the editing in that scene is very slow because the deadly pauses is making you understand that De Niro realizes he's in big trouble.
Putting this place out of commission.
For who? Now's not the time to not say.
So normally you would have cut that scene faster, but the richness of the acting, it was our job to make sure that we honored that and that we got the absolute best out of it. I think editors need a strong sense of discipline, a musical sense, which fortunately I had. I had been trained to play instruments and the piano, so that is very important.
And the winner is... Thelma Schoonmaker for The Departed.
Thank you.
But you also have to not let your ego play too much of a role in this because your job is to do what's right for the film. I have the best job in the world. I mean, collaborating with Marty is so special. Anyone who works with him will tell you this. I mean, the reward is huge. You work terribly hard. It's exhausting, but it is worth it. I just want to go on and on as long as I can.
Thank you very much for the session, Abhijit sir.
Thank you. I hope that the ideas are clear. Okay. And we'll go in this way. So it will be easy for you to walk the path. Okay. Okay. Thank you. And please fill the feedback form.
Thank you, sir.
Everybody requested to fill the form. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
We'll have another session later on. Okay.